Gracias.
Take your seat, please.
Gracias.
Yamini.
Yes, sir.
No, chill out. Feel relaxed.
You belong to Vellore?
Yes, sir.
That's a very nice. Why is Vellore famous?
Sir, Vellore is famous for Vellore Mutiny, which happened in 1806, much before the First War of Independence.
That mutiny lasted for what time?
Sir, it lasted only for a day or two, sir.
Oh, for a day, okay.
For a day.
Yeah. That was the first Indian mutiny against the British.
Yes, sir.
Isn't it? In India, that was the first one.
First okay. Mutiny against the
Why British. Why it is famous now? Vellore. Why Vellore is famous now?
How?
Now?
Now, it is famous for Christian Medical College.
Yes.
Which was which was built by Dr. Ida Scudder. And now famous for Golden Temple, Vellore Fort. That's it. Specifically, now currently it is famous, I'm not sure. Sir.
Okay. You have taken sociology optional?
Yes, sir.
Why?
Sir, I felt sociology would help me understand the realities of society in a more intense way, sir, than taking any other optional. Understanding the society would help me in the administration as well, sir. So I thought sociology would be a better option.
Okay. Have you heard of National Register of Citizens?
Yes, sir.
What is that?
It is a registry which, I'm not sure of that.
You have not heard about National Register of Citizens?
Yes, I heard it, but I couldn't say it properly, you know. Sir.
National Population Register?
Yes, sir.
You have heard?
Yes, sir.
What is that?
It is accounting for the residents of India, which is carried out in almost all parts of the India, sir.
It's covered already?
No, sir. It is in implementation stage.
But it came in 2010.
Sorry, sir, I'm not.
Citizens Amendment Act, have you heard?
Yes, sir.
What is that?
It is for providing citizenship for the persecuted minorities in the neighboring countries of Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Afghanistan, sir.
Is Afghanistan a neighboring state?
Yes, sir.
Oh?
It adjoins some part of Jammu Kashmir at the top.
Gilgit-Baltistan.
Sir?
Pak-occupied Kashmir. Gilgit-Baltistan, it has 150 km of border with India, technically, isn't it?
Yes.
That means, okay. So, from these three countries, who are the people who have to be given citizenship?
The minorities of those countries, religious, persecuted religious minorities of those countries like Hindus, Christians, Buddhists, Jains, Zoroastrians, and one more community,
Six communities.
Six.
And why these three countries have been taken? Why not others?
That is where religious persecution was predominant in those countries, sir.
But religious persecution, how do they prove? The person has to prove that he was persecuted. How do they prove?
The decline in the population of those minorities in those countries can be one such proof.
Simply becoming a minority doesn't entitle you to citizenship here. He must be persecuted. And not only persecution, but also fear of persecution. How shall you prove those things?
Sir, I feel the decrease in the population of those minorities could be taken as one example, like they are persecuted.
Why three countries have been selected?
Sorry, sir, I'm not sure.
So, like, let us say, Tamils of Sri Lanka. They are the most persecuted. The Rohingyas in Myanmar and now even 7 lakhs in Bangladesh. Why not they are Muslims? Why not they?
Sorry, sir. I am not sure.
Even the Uyghur Muslims of China, okay, in Xinjiang province, even they are persecuted. They are persecuted the most. There are concentration camps. They are kept. Why they have not been taken?
Sorry.
Why these three countries only?
I'll read into it, sir. I'm not sure, sir.
It's okay. Some states have said that they will not obey the Citizenship Act and National Population Register and others. Some states have said. And Kerala has gone to Supreme Court. Do you think a state government has a choice not to obey central laws?
Sir, as per the constitution, the state governments has to oblige with the orders of central government. But they can also voice their grievances against the government, sir. But it is the central government that finally decides.
No, you are not very clear. What is Article 246? Have you seen Article 246?
No, sir.
Article 356?
Yes, sir.
What is that?
The orders of central government has to be carried out by the state government. If not, Article 356 is President's rule, sir.
Yes, 356 is President's rule. If in the opinion of the President, the administration of a state cannot be carried on in accordance with the constitution, then you will declare to that effect. Okay. So, can you impose Article 356? If they do not obey the state, the central government's laws and instructions under Article 246?
It can be, sir.
How? After S.R. Bommai judgment in 1993, Article 356 has become a dead letter practically. Okay, so how shall they do it?
Sorry, sir.
Okay, take it. Okay, please, come on.
You had said that you had taken sociology in order to know the realities of the society. So after taking sociology as an option, what are the realities of society that you have understood?
Sir, I have learned to see the other side of the problem, like why people are actually behaving in such a manner, why there is social problem and change occurring, which is anticipated and non-anticipated, functional and dysfunctional aspects of some practices within communities, etc. That are all.
Can you give some examples also?
Sir, we have read about Sanskritization of the sociological thinker M.N. Srinivasan. I have felt that process even in my own family, where a ritually lower caste imitates the practices of a ritually higher caste. Though they cannot get a caste mobility, they can't rise the ladder of the caste, they feel that even if we try to imitate their practices, we will gain some recognition like that. So they adapt the practices of higher caste. This practice, even I have felt, it is carried out widely in many places.
That you would be knowing even otherwise, like even before taking UPSC as an option.
So no, sir, I didn't know why we were taking these kind of practices.
So how did M.N. Srinivas give an outline of why this practice is taken? What is the advantage which a community gets by adopting the lifestyle of another community?
Sir, it is basically the recognition they need, sir. They feel dominated by the upper caste, but they cannot rise the ladder of the caste because of restrictions like occupation, birth, that all decides their, restricts their mobility. But in terms of ritual practices, if they try to adapt that, they feel they are equal to the upper caste.
Okay, so Tamil Nadu, you are from Tamil Nadu, right? It is known for many social movements. The most famous among that was the Dravidian movement.
Yes, sir.
So is Sanskritization, the concept of Sanskritization, it's in direct contradiction with that of the Dravidian politics?
Yes, sir, to an extent.
Like, you'll have to, say it in more detail. Like, to an extent is like...
Sir, Dravidian movements basically wanted to overthrow the dominance of upper caste. They opted for self-respect movement, wherein they went even for self-respect marriages where the upper caste were not involved in the process of marriage. The lower caste tried to prove their identity on their own. So we can tell like Sanskritization is removing your own identity and going behind someone's identity. But Dravidian movements opted for showcasing your own identity rather than following the rules of the upper caste.
And in Tamil Nadu, has there been any example where any community has tried to do Sanskritization, like follow the Sanskritization practices of upper castes?
Sir, it happens.
So can you name one or two communities which have done?
Sir, it happens in pockets of places where most of the Vaishyas take the practices of upper caste, sir, lower caste people.
So, is it that North India has taken to Sanskritization in order to like counter this casteism, and South India has believed in self-respect movement in order to like bring an end to the upper caste dominance?
Sir, can you please repeat the
question? In North India, to counter this upper caste dominance, people have adopted Sanskritization. In South India, in order to counter the upper caste dominance, people have followed the Dravidian movement. Is it like that, or like has it happened in North also, like this self-respect?
Sir, I'm not sure of the self-respect movements in North, but even they are trying to establish their own identity over the former caste.
Okay, and regarding this, Kerala government has gone against the central government's like act which was passed in the parliament. Is it a contradiction to federalism, to the concept of federalism?
Sir, every government can voice their resentment against the government, but
you can go to Supreme Court only if there is a dispute between the center and state. This is not a dispute per se. It's like suppose it's like water sharing or something like that. Only then they can go directly to Supreme Court. Or do you think the Kerala government could have simply passed a resolution in the assembly against CA? What was the need to go to Supreme Court?
Sorry, I have no idea.
Okay, and you had specified in your DAF that you were in faculty in NIT Trichy. What was the role, your role in that? I mean, what was your work profile in NIT Trichy?
Sir, I handled three subjects and one laboratory, sir. I took classes for BTEC and MTEC students.
In which subject?
In cognitive radio, environmental engineering and basics of electronics.
Oh, were you an alumni of NIT Trichy?
No, sir.
So they recruit even outside?
It's only an ad hoc faculty, contract like status. Like for an year, they will recruit from other colleges.
So do you think, you have said environmental engineering, right? You have been a faculty in that. Can it be, like, will it help you in your, like as a civil servant, when you carry out the activities in whichever service you get? Will environmental engineering play a role? If so, how?
Yes, sir. Most of the development projects and infrastructure projects are in direct tussle with the environmental issues in recent times. So having a knowledge of environment will better help in better policy framing, sir.
Can you give an example?
Sir, for example, the coal-bed methane project, which is an issue in Tamil Nadu, the neutrino observatory project and various dams that were constructed across India, and the environmental movements against by the people can are some examples.
Okay, sir.
Yes. Imagine that as a civil servant, you are working in a rural environment where there is frequent caste conflicts. What will be your long-term and short-term measures to counter, reduce this problem?
Sir, as a short-term measure, I would sit with the caste groups which are in conflict. I will directly try to address them and provide some short-term relief. In the long term, there has to be behavioral changes in the system, society itself. So we'll start with the schools in the education system. where students from across every caste will be made into one group, where they can share their experience, or they will be, I can make like people from different caste, students from different caste groups into one house, like different houses we can create and inculcate them some team spirit and then like that.
Caste is good, no? It gives me a sort of identity, social identity. What is your view on caste?
Sir, as far as that identity doesn't discriminate other people and doesn't deprive others of their esteem, caste identity is good, sir.
Sometimes we say education as a solution to some of the problems in the context of caste.
Sir?
Some people say, look, if there is a change in the economic condition, there will be a, you know, there will be a reduced number of conflicts.
Yes, sir.
Which one do you think is the real problem, is, you know, the real solution? Is it an economic solution or education?
Sir, I think both has to be addressed simultaneously, sir. That's why even the Constitution of India has provided a reservation based on educational as well as economic backwardness. There is a concept called dominant caste where numerically high and economically powerful people can alter the caste dynamics of that place. So even economics helps to some extent, and education is even more powerful when it comes in changing the caste dynamics.
The competition brings out the best, even in civil service, the best students are chosen. In a corporate environment, best are chosen in a competitive. This reservation defeats the whole idea of competition and quality in terms of, you know, employees or, you know.
Sir, not exactly, sir. Where some people were not even allowed to enter the competition, there should be a level playing field for all the people to take part in the activity. So there has to be reservations.
Thank you.
You belong to the new district of Tamil Nadu. So which other district got trifurcated from Velur?
Sir, ma'am, it is Ranipet. And Tirupattur got trifurcated from Velur.
And which other three districts have been formed?
In recent
Velur, but along with Tirupattur, the other three districts which were?
Ma'am, it is, I'm not sure of the districts.
Okay. It's okay. Have you heard of Sendai framework?
Yes, ma'am.
So, in the social aspect, which particular goals have been set in Sendai framework for the risk reduction which a population could get protected during a disaster?
I'm not aware of that much details of the Sendai framework, ma'am.
Okay.
Sorry.
And okay, for the social welfare, which particular sustainable development goals have been set, which targets for the as a security for the female population?
It is sustainable development goal 5, which opts for gender equality, and there are some other goals also. I'm not able to recollect the numbers exactly.
So you have your degree on with wireless communication and satellites. So in what way should we implement the wireless communication much more better, so that the information dissemination becomes much more easier to all the parts of the country? That's one. And who is deprived of this entire communication facility in the country, these two questions.
How wireless communication has to be?
So that the dissemination of information could be made much more faster and equivalent to all the population.
First, digital literacy has to be developed among the population. to learn about how our system of communication works. And digital infrastructure has to be built. Even in the for the last mile connectivity and in the remote places also, there has to be communication so information can be disseminated properly. The population which is deprived is mostly the tribal population and some pockets of remote locations in the country.
And my second one was, second question was?
Which population is deprived of?
So it has been answered. You have mentioned your one of your hobbies to be watching movies. Okay. What kind of movies?
I watch mostly from Tamil, Malayalam and Hindi.
Okay.
Mostly all genres.
Why Malayalam? Malayalam,
my friend was Malayali, sir, so I got...
So now recently many Tamilians are watching Malayalam movies. This was not a trend earlier. Why is it so?
Maybe because of the simplicity of the movies, I think, ma'am. Mm-hmm. Low budget movies, but with good messages and script.
So all these Telugu, Kannada movies, they're all like not simple,
high budget movies.
I feel they predominantly produce commercial kind of movies with, so that may not be dealing with a common man.
So our taste has changed?
Yes, ma'am, it
is. Our taste has changed? So, why is Vijay in news recently?
Because of the IT raids that happened in his home.
Okay. So, any information which you have?
No.
About any private information?
Yes, sir.
Yamini.
Yes, sir.
By giving a clue, I am asking this question. This question is related with the first question, which was asked to you about 1806. Next year, India is going to celebrate 100th year of an important event. What was it? I repeat, a clue that is connected with the 1806.
The
100th year of an important event. Okay, I'll go further. It is connected with Indian freedom struggle. 1921 is a watershed year in India's freedom struggle. What was it? And we are going to celebrate the 100th year of it tomorrow, next year.
Civil disobedience.
Can you go beyond that? In an important event. I'll give you another clue. It was the killing of 6 policemen.
Chauri Chaura
incident. Huh? Yes. What was so unique about this, the Chauri Chaura incident? Because there is a theory that Mahatma Gandhi was so rigid in his principles that if only Gandhiji would not have called off the strike, India would have got independence.
Century year begins.
Before 1947. What happened in
Chauri Chaura? The way the mob fired a police station during the course of civil disobedience. Because of that, Gandhi.
Then what happened? Can you just portray the incident? What happened and what went wrong?
Sir, I'm aware of this only event that they fired it. So Gandhiji suspended the movement as it is against non-violence and not in a constitutional way. He suspended.
When the whole nation was on the move, he has suspended the movement. There are raging debates even now, of course, this has happened 100 years ago. But still, when any student of Indian freedom struggle cannot bypass this incident.
Sorry, sir.
Okay. So, okay. Now, since you belong to Tamil Nadu, what is your view on Jallikattu?
Sir, it's a cultural sport that's been in practice since many long years.
Mm.
It has been even mentioned in a Tamil epic. So,
So, do we, the court has allowed it, okay. But do we need Jallikattu?
Yes, sir, but with regulated
measures. What regulation?
Like, it should be ensured that the animals are not tormented during the game.
Hmm.
And medical facilities has to be around away.
In spite of all the precautions, we are not able to stop the death of persons. This year alone, over 6 persons were killed. 5 of them are either bull tamers or spectators. But there was one policeman, 29-year-old policeman, who was standing as guard. He was killed because the bull went into his, ran over him and he got killed. It was a gory death. And he was the only son of his poor mother. Now my question is that how will you justify this? And do we still need this sport, this so-called sport?
Yeah.
You can justify, at least in the sense, justify in the sense logically one can understand the killing of, the death of 5 people because either they are bull tamers or participants who know the risks and went there. But what about this policeman? He is just a constable and the only breadwinner of the family. And he will answer the tears of his mother. He is now a loner. Do you still support this Jallikattu?
Sir, any event will have both positive and negative effects.
Positive and negative.
We have to make sure better safeguard procedures and we can continue.
And this happened after several precautionary measures, which includes 25 veterinarians, 35 para veterinarians, over a dozen ambulances, scores of policemen, district officials, even the committee was present. But still a lone constable was standing away from the venue, got killed. Is this a necessary killing? Is this a necessary one, a risk worth taken in life? Was he recruited to the force to get killed in this manner? It is an unavoidable one can understand. He was killed while chasing a robbers or chasing some antisocials. Or killed by while on his duty, protecting the country and the society. Do you understand? Do you catch what I am trying to say?
Yes, sir.
I'm asking the other side of Jallikattu. Everybody is now saying that Jallikattu is wanted. I'm asking the other side. Is it not barbaric? Can any civil society allow this? Cruelty to animals is one angle. Innocents get killed.
Sir, if in case this continues in long term,
that is some more over a dozen constables killed in the next 3 to 4 years, you will change your opinion.
Sir, not that way.
Don't forget one thing, that the persons killed, uniformed persons killed, only at the lower level. Not most senior police officer is getting killed. Anyway, you think about it. See, you are an engineer. I mean, you're a highly qualified person. Why do you want to become a civil servant?
Sir, because
at the end of the day, you will be at the call of politicians. You have to carry out their orders. You will not have any say.
Sir, I thought taking this job would have a diversity of challenges.
Hmm.
I could cater to the needs of larger sections of people than to an arrow set like students.
Hmm.
So, this would be more challenging, I thought.
That's the only reason.
Yes, sir.
Just then you wasted 6 years, B and M, you know. You would have studied sociology or literature or history, any humanities subject.
Sir, I could implement the technical knowledge which I gained from my college studies in the administration.
Recently, two IAS officers have resigned after CA. Do you know their names?
The one is from Kerala, I'm not
what
sure.
What was his name?
Kannan is. I'm not sure.
Another one? Another one is a Tamilian, but he's a Karnataka kid.
Sorry, I couldn't.
Okay, leave alone the names. Do you, as a future civil servant, do you support, do you endorse what they have did?
Sir, no, sir.
Why?
When it comes to the professional choice, one has to oblige with, one has to subside his personal choices. Because it is the government that formulates policies for the people and we are implementing it. So there has to be no tussle between your personal ideology and the government ideology.
If they feel that my allegiance is only to the Constitution of India, not to the rulers, and my conscience says that this particular act violates the Constitution, and I am resigning. I am not doing anything against the society or government. I am not taking arms. I am just answering my conscience. So in that sense, how will you say they are wrong? And they have gone to the people. They have not done anything wrong.
Sir, they have to, they could have voiced their resentment to their, to the government.
What will happen? Nothing is going to change. Now justify your stand, I'm asking. Anyway, think about it. Sir.
Okay.
Initially itself, you should say that you are not aware. Like when one question was asked, you were about to start, you started saying something and then said, I'm not aware of it. So. That one, and then the CA, NRC and NPR are the most important topics, so you can't say that I'm not aware of that. You should be very thorough of it. And one more, you said it's the state's duty to implement the order of the central government. That is just a layman's language. More preferable would be like an act passed in the parliament or like law passed in parliament, which the central government is, like implementing. It's like not an order of the central government. And then it's 100th year of non-cooperation, not civil disobedience. Yes. 1920 was non-cooperation. So that one. And then like if you ask something like to an extent like that, there should be instances or examples. Like the faculty should not ask to tell an example. Like
okay,
whatever question is asked, you tell the concept, followed by one or two examples, it's very good. And then when sir asked like that two bureaucrats have resigned, you said he's from Kerala. You don't need to start with the native place of the bureaucrats, like that one. And then when sir asked like politicians direct the bureaucrat, like when you become a bureaucrat, politicians will be like giving the orders that only implement. It's a, like that you said that you want to serve the society, but you didn't counter that question of sir, that politicians or like you should say, no, there is civil service neutrality. If politicians are asking us to implement unconstitutional orders, we'll oppose it. You'll have to like say, be firm on that.
Okay, sir.
Because many in IAS and IPS, especially local level politicians, they'll ask you to do so many unconstitutional things, for which you'll be able to say no. The panel will be looking whether you'll be able to maintain the neutrality or not. So,
Kannan Gopinathan's case, I'll just give you one small information. This is actually a fact. Kannan Gopinathan is saying, after abrogation of Article 37, he was the first one to resign, then only Sasikanth, the second. The second guy, Sasikanth Senthil, resigned. Kannan Gopinathan says, he's a Kerala cadre officer, he was administrator of Dadanagar Haveli. No, he was some specific point. He was saying that, I'm not questioning the, as his argument, I'm not questioning the centers, the union government's power to abrogate 370. Perfectly, the center has got the power. But at the same time, the people of Jammu and Kashmir have also got their right. Constitutionally guaranteed right to protest it. Since the government is not giving that right and denying that right to protest, I am resigning. Just look at it carefully. He is not questioning the center's decision or right to abrogate a particular article, Article 370. He says the center may be well within its rights to abrogate it. After all, the matter is the court and the courts will take a decision. But the second one is that likewise the people have a right to protest, which is a constitutionally guaranteed right. Since that was not allowed, I am resigning.
Sir, question, what should be the stand?
Sir will tell you.
In Jammu and Kashmir.
She's asked what stand she should take in the poll.
In Jammu and Kashmir, the article has not been abrogated, it has been inactivated.
No, with respect to the civil servants resigning.
Protest. That is their personal choice, but what view you take is that what the government has done is almost right. Because of many reasons. First, it is a temporary provision. Now, I will have to very elaborate on this because some days back I gave a 15-minute speech on that because this one candidate asked the same question when all others were sitting, Chandru was sitting also. Now, let us go to Article 370. Article 371 says that if the president extends any item beyond what is written in the instrument of accession, then he has to take the approval of the state legislative assembly. 373 says if any part of this article is to be changed, then the approval of the constituent assembly is to be taken. So constituent assembly of Jammu and Kashmir existed from 1952 to 1957, January 26. Okay. The constitution was adopted on November 17th, 1956. Okay. So, it is no more there. Article 370 came in 1949. Who drafted Article 370?
Sir, by the order of President, it was introduced.
Article 370 was drafted by whom?
Gopal
Swami Iyengar. Yesterday somebody gave me a reply, it is by Nehru or Patel. No. Gopal Swami Iyengar. By Gopal Swami Iyengar, who was the Dewan of Maharaja Hari Singh from 1937 to 42. So he was the main person that he entered the Constitutional Assembly in 1948 and 49, and this was drafted. Okay. He said the Jammu Kashmir is not yet ripe for full integration to India. So the instrument of accession has been signed, but they have not merged with India. That is what they are saying. All others have merged, other states. Which is the last state to merge? Manipur, 1949, Manipur. Okay. So, it was in 1949 that 370 was drafted, by which time there is no constituent assembly, but there is a reference to constituent assembly. So, both are existing at different times. Okay. Supposing, I am giving one option. Supposing Article 370 would not have been drafted in 1949, it would have been drafted as a constitution amendment in 1958 or 60, let us say. Okay. Then could they have told that you will take the approval of the constituent assembly?
No.
No, they cannot say because it is already over. So, two situations I am giving when constituent assembly doesn't exist. One is after Article 370 came, one is before Article 370 came. So, they have in a very devious way, surreptitious way, they have tried to make this article permanent, even though it was a temporary provision. So, Constitutional Assembly's approval is to be taken till the Constitutional Assembly exists. After its existence, how can approval be taken? Okay. So, what Government of India has done is right, but they have done it in a different way altogether. They have done it in a very different way. What they have done? The Constitutional Assembly has been equated with the State Legislative Assembly, as because it is no more, it is not under suspension animation, it is dissolved. Then Parliament has the power, so Parliament's approval is taken. So this is the way they have taken. What they have done is correct. Article 370 has really become a stumbling block. So if you have seen Kashmir, Kashmir totally exists on India's grants. Nothing is happening there for the last 20 years. No tourism, nothing, no revenue, nothing. So it is completely existing on Indian grants. So what the government has done, the government done the right thing. But the problem was the permanent residency. Permanent residency, then what happened? In 1952, there was an agreement between Nehru and Sheikh Abdullah. As per this agreement, presidential order is not passed. 1953, Sheikh Abdullah, again talked of plebiscites, so independence. So Nehru put him under prison from 1953 to 1975, 22 years he was in prison. Then a person called Bakshi Ghulam Muhammad was made the chief minister, was more pro-India. So he approved in the Constitutional Assembly the first order of the presidential order for Kashmir, which you find in the Constitutional Appendix 1. So the first presidential order was passed in 1954, and which says in Article 35A. 35A should be the fundamental rights chapter, because the directive principle starts from 36. So, but it is not the fundamental rights chapter. It is in the Appendix 1 on the presidential order. So 35A says that Jammu Kashmir Legislative Assembly has to be the authority to define who is a permanent resident. A permanent resident has got some benefit. First benefit is that only they can inherit the property and buy property there. Second, they can have all the government jobs and government scholarships. Third, they will vote in the local election and assembly election. Outsiders can vote in, also can vote in parliament election. So these are the three benefits. Okay. Now this was called state subject law so far as Pak occupied Kashmir is concerned. Now Pakistan has violated that, withdrew the state subject law in 1974. Now we have done it so that others can buy property there. But there are other states also in India, like Uttarakhand, you cannot buy property there unless you are resident there. So like some northeastern states, so the same thing happens.
Okay.
But if Jammu Kashmir, other people are allowed to buy property there, then it will no more be Jammu and Kashmir or Bhuswarg. It will be a Rajasthan desert. Bombay people have got so much money, they will all buy land there. It will die there. This thing came in 1927. First permanent residence law was enacted by Maharaja Haji Singh. At that time, actually the provision was, if you are born before 1911 or you have property for 10 years in Jammu Kashmir, then you can buy property here, become a permanent citizen. But that one, it was slowly being changed. Okay. But the difficulty is that permanent residents, if a boy marries an outsider girl, then the girl will also be permanent citizen, their children can also inherit property, they become permanent citizens. But if a girl marries an outsider, then all will lose. So this could have been addressed by a simple changing that law, that if a girl also marries an outsider, in that case also they will be permanent citizen. It's simple. So because of this, they have changed everything. Okay, so you support the government of India, that what they have drawn is correct, and it is a devious way of making a temporary provision for how many years? 70 years have gone. The temporary provision as permanent, look like permanent. Okay, so this should be your view. And so far as the central laws are concerned, obeying this thing, as per Article 246 and 365, executive instructions given by the Government of India. Executive instructions of Government of India can be given only executive powers. Executive powers are coterminous with the legislative powers. That means list one of 7. So it means Government of India cannot give an instruction, law and order. Because it is a state subject, but they can give on the central subjects. On those subjects only they can give an instruction, on central subjects. So that, as per Article 365, Article 356 can be employed in the state. Because 365 defines that if an instruction is not adhered to by a state government, it will be legitimate for the president to hold, lawful for the president to hold, that the administration of the state cannot be carried on in accordance with the Constitution. Only one instance where Article 356 has been clearly said that it can be applied. One instance, the whole Constitution. So this you can argue that when instruction is given as per the executive power of the central government, the legislative subjects, only that case only Article 356 can be applied.
Okay.
Okay.
Sir, and regarding the Jallikattu, what stand I should take?
What suggestion? Jallikattu, she is asking. I was actually cornering her.
We are not discussing what is right and wrong. What is opinion are you giving, and how are you strengthening, how are you supporting your opinion?
So can go with the previous stand, like you can continue the sport itself.
370 and CIA take the government's line. Jallikattu, you take your own. All the best.
Thank you, sir.
All the best.